for the regular council meeting Monday, November 16, 2015, at 7 p.m. We're not coming over. Call for order, please.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Zambach?
Present.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Craybach?
Here.
Mr. Mike Lowry?
Here.
All present.
Thank you, sir. We'll now have the invocation by City Councilman John Craybach. Please.
Let's just take a minute of silence for the tragedy in France, in Paris. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord God, in a moment of silence for the 120-plus that was killed and the 200 or 300 people that was hurt, many of them in ICU. We pray for peace in this world, Lord God. We pray, Heavenly Father, that our military will come and protect us. We pray for that our leaders in government will be wise in their decisions. We pray, Heavenly Father, for our meeting tonight. We're making a decision, several decisions tonight, Lord God. We ask for your help. Give us knowledge and empower us with your peace and love. Amen.
Amen. You now join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. Please, the flag in the back, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you all for being here this evening. If you have a cell phone, please put it on vibrate and turn it off, please, so you don't interrupt the meeting if you'd be so kind. And again, thank you for being here. I will now continue on. May I have action on the minutes of the regular meeting of November 2nd, 2015?
Second.
Any questions on the minutes? Council, anyone at all?
Mr. Zambach?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craybach?
Abstain due to absence.
Mr. Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Minutes passed 6-0-1.
Thank you. Communications. Mr. Marshall Gorby, a Christmas parade. I could say that a couple times, if you would, please. Would you go up to the podium, please? Thank you. Identify yourself. Not that we don't know who you are.
Marshall Gorby. I've been asked to come talk about the 30th anniversary of the Christmas parade. It's going to be December 5th, down Main Street. We'll have the Tecumseh Marching Band with us this year again, as usual. We only had them maybe just one year. We didn't have them. Santa will fly in to Andy Barnhart Memorial Airport at 9:30. If you want to bring your kids, I know when I started at the New Carlisle Sun in the 70s, there were a lot of kids out there. Now we're down to about maybe 10. I'd like to see a lot of them come out there. It's really cool to watch him fly in and get out of the airplane. So it's really a nice event. He will be transported to Main Street by the fire department, right, Mr. Ritter? Yes, there you go. And they always bring him up for us. The parade will start at 10 o'clock. We will go up Main Street, make a left onto Lake, and then to the firehouse. Unless it's really bad weather. Last year, for the first time, we didn't have a parade because the weather was so cold and rainy and wet. We just couldn't do it, but we opened up. The fire department took all their equipment out. We had the band inside. We had all the costume characters. We had punch. We had all kinds of great things for the kids and candy. They got to dance with the characters. It was really a good time. So, and also this year we're going to have special candy canes made by Mike Lowry's wife, April. He had little Rudolph light ones for the 30th anniversary. They're really neat. We have little stickers on them that commemorate it being the 30th anniversary for all the kids to have some. We'll have a lot of costume characters there. There's a contest. If you march in the parade and you have your kids dressed up as a Christmas package, a Christmas tree, or a Christmas character, you can march in the parade, and then we have gift cards to give the first, second, third place winners. The local merchants also have their open house at the same time. So It's our 30th anniversary. The first year I did this was with Mad Shellhouse, was city manager. I don't know if everybody remembers that or not. But I asked her about starting a parade, and she agreed. I think our first parade was maybe the band took off and left us, and we were kind of wondering where they went to. But every year they've come back, and we've gotten bigger and bigger. So hopefully this year will be a nicer, better event. With help of Heritage of Flight, letting us raise money with them, with us, we raise money that we don't have to ask people for money this year. We usually have to mooch off the businesses or the banks. But luckily, we've been auctioning. People give us stuff to auction off, and it's become, we pretty much try to take care of ourselves so we don't have to ask, because everybody gets hit so hard for donations. So we're very lucky. So but this is our 30th year. Come out, watch Santa. We'll go up to the firehouse. Lots of candies for all the kids. There'll be lots of costume characters. Olaf from Frozen will be there. We've got two Minions. We've got the K99 will be there also. Grimm from Mother Goose and Grimm will be there. So we'll have a lot of neat things. So, and the Tecumseh Marching Band, who we are very grateful to have every year.
I think the city manager has guaranteed good weather this year.
Yeah. Excellent.
Now, one other question I have. Is there anything going on that evening?
Well, there is.
I think we should mention that.
Are we doing a tree? Are you doing your tree lighting, sir?
Yeah, that was in the other business section, but if you want me to, I can jump to it now.
Because it works right in.
That's what I was thinking. All right. But the idea was a lot of cities and communities do like ceremonial Christmas tree lightings. And as a little boy, I used to sing in a choir in elementary school. And we actually had lit the tree and I had sung to it, you know. So I thought, oh, that'd be really cool to start it again. So I've talked with city manager and the mayor, and Mr. Lowry, Mr. McIntyre, and a few other members of council decided, well, let's do it again. So the idea is at 2:30 after the parade and after all that stuff, come down, bring any ornament that you want for the community, and we're going to do a community Christmas decorating so our tree can look even better, because last year didn't look so great. So we're definitely going to try to bring that up to speed. And then at 6:30, we're going to do have a local group sing for us. It's right now in the air between either rock caroling, possibly, or the show choir, whichever one wants to get back to me first, I guess, and confirm. So we'll be doing that, and then we'll light the tree, and then we'll sing Oh Christmas Tree, and there'll be punch, hot cider I'll be buying, and some Christmas cookies.
Thank you. All right.
Yeah, I think it'll be a nice addition for the day. It really will. I mean,
amen.
We carry over, and then...
It all comes together.
Yeah, then just short days after that, we have the ball drop.
One other thing.
Yes.
For 30 years, thank you so much.
Well, you're welcome.
Welcome to day over 31.
Thank you very much.
You're doing a very good job. Thanks, Marshall. Appreciate it. City manager, great report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of the public, and guests. I'd like to share the city manager's report with you. We're going to start first off with the action report. The major project right now is Twin Creeks. Everyone knows that it did go through the land reutilization program offered by the state of Ohio. So now that those deeds are in our position, the question is what are the next steps? With the packets, I put in a copy of ORC 5722, which runs the guidelines for the land reutilization program. So we have to follow everything in that guideline. But I did supply everybody with just a brief outline of steps of where I'm currently at with this. First one, I have to locate an ordinance that our former law director had, council had passed. We needed to make sure that the ordinance is compliant from a regulatory, and also our plan of how we're going to go about getting rid of these parcels need to be in there as well. So we need to make sure that ordinance is correct. If it's not, we'll have to take our next steps to correct that ordinance. And if it is so, we'll just expand on to what we already have in place. Now, the big thing that needs to be done, if you also notice with the packet, there's an Excel sheet right here that has a list of all the ordinances on there. Well, you notice a column is blank, and that's the fair market value. We have to get that as appraised because it spells out pretty dry in Chapter 5722 of the Ohio Revised Code that these parcels cannot be sold for anything less than fair market value. I do know that there was a prior agreement that was not signed, and from our former city manager, we had a buyer who wanted to buy a bulk price of the buy at bulk and spend about $7,000 per parcel. Well, if we determine that the fair market value is increased, we have to sell them for what that is. City of Springfield also went through a similar program, so I'm going to be contacting with them and try to get as many what I call free lunches as we possibly can. We're not going to reinvent the wheel. If what they did, we can just copy it. We are all operating under the 5722 of the Ohio Revised Code, so whatever they did, we can mirror. We do have an orphan parcel that did not make it onto the last sheriff's sale that's included on the Excel sheet. So that will be added, and the next sheriff's sale is January 8th, and there's a second one on January 22nd of 2016. So once we get past that, nobody bids on it, it comes back to the city, just as these other 26 have done in the past. Now, again, even though we have that potential bulk buyer, I still think that we should market these as individual to see what we get. Put them out there for a couple of weeks. Why are we trying to shoot ourselves short if we can sell 20 of them at fair market and then maybe bundle the prices up with the potential buyer that we had as well? So basically, we need to do our due diligence and get the last penny that we can get from these parcels. So that's where we're at now. It is a big task. It is, again, I've been saying it since we've had the deeds in our possession, we're not going to rush this. I don't want this program to be not followed by state law and then them come back and say, you didn't sell these properly, you owe us money, or what other ramification that can come because we did not follow the guidelines of 5722. So if anybody has any questions on Twin Creeks, I'll field them right now before we get past it.
Counsel. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Okay, if you have them right now, what you do, if someone, anyone, came and bought them at fair market value, what do they owe besides the price that they have paid?
That is something else that we're trying to get to the bottom of. It's the assessments too are off, but do they continue on staying on for the infrastructure bond? So
that's really what I want to know.
Sure.
The assessment was still on. It's paid off.
No, the assessment was paid off with past, but then you have the infrastructure bonds that we're still paying on too.
But it's a 20-year assessment. Mm-hmm. So if they've been there for 10 or 11 years, there should only be 9.
Sure. Logic should say that, yes.
Okay,
but again, at the last council meeting, said I'm talking with Bill Hoffman. He's a prosecuting attorney for Clark County. He can't give us legal advice because he doesn't work for us, but he has been a great tool at this point in time.
Okay.
So those are some of the questions that we still need to get answered.
Okay.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
Anybody else? Counselor, yes.
You had a question about speaking with Mr. Hoffman, Counselor Hoffman. I know you were trying to find out what the best way to go forward with this is, and I really want to thank you for doing this slowly because we can't drop the ball on this again. So thank you for taking due diligence. Did you find out any more information from him, or is that what the meeting with Springfield is going to hopefully reveal, how they went forward? Because if he can't legally give us advice.
You nailed it right on the head.
Okay.
He can point us in a direction, but he can't say do this or do that. He's kind of almost speaking in essentially.
So you're meeting with the city manager in Springfield?
And it's not the city manager, it's going to be their finance director.
Finance director.
Yep.
Anyone else, counsel? Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Well, I don't know if they're related, but is Kennedy Trust related to any of this?
It is not particularly related to this particular matter. I did get an update. We had spent a couple days, me and our attorney, going through I hate to say this, but it's the truth. Our prior law director didn't answer questions that their counsel had. He just let them sit there for almost 2 years unanswered. Mm-hmm. Well, when Lynette came aboard and was getting up to speed with it, she had reached out to Clark County Courts to allow us to reissue the answers to those questions. We did, and it took about 2 or 3 days to answer all of them, but it's still sitting in the courts. So we don't know if they're going to honor that or not. So we're still just waiting for the courts. And that's unfortunate because when you deal with the court system, it is a slow process. If it does end up coming back to us, we've already discussed, and I don't want to get too ahead of ourselves, but if it does come back in our possession, do we allow it to go into another program similar to this? Because there's still a lot of, past the set of taxes on that haven't been paid.
Right.
So
exactly.
Basically, we're waiting for the court to respond to us to see if they're going to allow the questions that we answered into the case.
Yeah, I just want people to know that there is a part two to it.
There is a part two to it. So
chapter three.
Yeah.
Anyone else, counsel? Citizens, anybody have a question? Out there on Twin Creeks at this point. Okay, we'll continue on.
Sure. Yep. Oh, I lost my spot. Give me 1 second. And moving on with the city manager report, our finance discussion with our finance director, Ms. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, and members of the public. I'm here with the October financial report. Our total revenue for the month of October was $629,237.63. Our total expenses for the month of October was $578,600.93. So our total year-to-date revenue collected is $4,408,279.23. Our total year-to-date expenses are $3,902,402.36. Income tax for the month of October, total income tax that we've collected is $99,023.72. Out of that number, for the 0.5% police income tax, we collected $18,682.77. So our total year-to-date on our income tax is $915,020.39, of which for the 0.5% police income tax levy, we have a total for the year of $33,581.81. In my report, I'm putting the final revenue and expenses for the pool. It's on my second page, and I'll just hit the highlights, and then if we have any questions. The total revenue that the pool took in for the whole season was $45,618.78. Total expenses for 2015 are $50,961.34, which made an operating loss for the 2015 season of $5,342.56. We already had in our budget to transfer from the general fund what we estimated. The transfer was going to be $39,600. We did not need that. We did transfer $10,000. So we have a little surplus carried over right now of $4,657.44. That's my report. If there's any questions, I can answer.
Any questions for the extra duty police for the festival, are you getting reimbursed for that?
No, we do not.
So that's, I don't, does Heritage Flight pay for that? Yeah. So that's what I wanted to know.
Anybody else, Council? Hey, going back to extra duty, I'd like everybody to know that our current two police officers, sheriff's deputies, have been doing extra duty. They put in more than 71 hours in the last month, and I want to commend you for that. Thank you very much. Between the two of you, that gives us extra protection in the city, and we appreciate that. Thank you so much. Hopefully we can get some other deputies stepping forward. Thank you. Anyone else at all? Yes.
I had one question on the check register form that you gave us. The first item is Verizon Wireless, $887. I know that's small compared to some of the other things that we're dealing with. That's for it's our general telephones, right, for the entire city, or can you explain that?
The very first check?
Yeah.
Let me get my detail report here.
Sorry about that.
No, that's why I bring it, so I can hopefully answer all of the questions. Cell phone service for Verizon, therefore the whole city, all the departments broken out. That's our monthly.
So every one of the city departments.
Yes,
what we
fire,
use
water department, sewer, our staff, everyone.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Any other questions?
One last question. Do we apply for any of like the salt reimbursement, the rock salt reimbursement with the Attorney General's office?
We didn't qualify because we didn't purchase from those companies during that time frame.
Just wanted to make sure. Thanks.
Anybody else? Council, anyone else? Thank you so much for your report. We appreciate it. Thanks for all your hard work.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Harris. And moving on with our city manager report, service discussion from our service director, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. Just a couple updates. Leave pickup is ongoing. We're about a day or so behind, but we will probably be caught up if the weather stays nice this week. Prentice Drive reconstruction is completed. That was from phase one, about 214 Prentice up to Kennison. That is done. I'm working with the county right now to do final quantities for their invoicing and get them paid. I think I was able to save us at least a couple thousand dollars on the project by non-perform items that they just didn't have to do. And then the last thing is, I think there's probably a lot of, there may be or may not be questions about the Speedway reconstruction. I have been on site quite frequently with that build, so I could entertain any questions on any of the items or Speedway in particular.
Did we pay, first off, the Speedway, when they put the new water main in, did they pay for that? And then then the water main just busted on Saturday, I believe it was a Friday, and did we have to pay to repair what they had just put in?
No, what they installed was a storm pipe in a ditch line, and then our 8-inch water main run perpendicular to where they put that in. It cracked probably about 2 foot past their ditch line, which is a cast iron pipe. It's not ductile like our newer ones. I was there for the whole compaction of that ditch. Coincidence.
Was it just coincidence? So there was it wasn't somehow related to them?
Right. No. Okay. Their ditch didn't get not filled correctly, settle, and it cracked it. No, not at all.
Just wanted to make sure.
Is that what we were working on today?
No, today was an abandonment of a service line that had went to that yellow house at the corner valley of the alley and lake. When we dug it up to for them to get ready to pour their approach, we noticed it's only about 2 feet under the dirt. Well, it never froze because of usage. Well, now if it's going to be under what's going to be 6 inches of concrete and about 12 inches plus of stone, and it's a fresh compaction, fresh soil, it's gonna freeze like that and probably pop, and then we will be liable for digging it up. So we went out to Lake to abandon it. Come to find out, when back in 1970-something, when AT&T put their ductwork in for their fiber and phone line, they laid it right on the corp stop, right on the main. So it ended up popping it today, and we had to do that repair. Yeah, there's been a few headaches. They're just related that we're having to do some work outside of the Speedway project, but we're getting into some of our old infrastructure that we're abandoning service lines off of.
Thank you. Council, other questions for service director?
Yes.
Yes.
What's their target date for open?
Tentative is December 15th. That was actually, should have been a lot earlier. What held them back was the shoring, which is a big metal plate that went up against that white house on the southern side of the property to install the new fuel tanks. There was a headache that they unanticipated for, because the basement of the house next door could have collapsed right into that hole when they had it dug, because they were close to 25 feet deep with that hole. But just to let everyone know, the new tanks going in are a new state-of-the-art fiberglass with sensors, and they are also putting in approximately 20-some monitoring and test wells for any residual vapors that they have to extract. But they're building on this extraction system with the new building, instead of having a trailer sitting there that was there before with a vapor. A temporary fence that won't be there anymore. It'll be a built-in part of the new structure.
You have a question?
Yes, sir. Yeah. Mr. Bridge or Howie, if you know, have they made a decision on the old Speedway across the street as far as opening it or leaving it closed? Or
no, it's up to, from what I understand, their marketing and corporate
meetings that we have.
We will.
Yeah. They'll keep doing business as it is.
Okay.
One other question I have for you, if you would. The light at Lake and Main, I'm getting a lot of questions about why is it so long now coming south in the new Galau 235. It seems to be out of sync.
It's the same timing. The only thing I have noticed, and we're going to check into this, is sometimes the wires that are in the road that check your magnetic field for triggering the arrow, the left turn arrow, to go north on 235 off of Lake, or heading east on Lake, turning left, that arrow triggers every time. We just noticed that. Other than that, that's the only thing that would stop the other traffic, but the timing is still.
I mean, sitting in Studebaker's in the morning, the traffic is literally almost down to IGA sometimes, backed up.
Oh, really?
I mean, that's how far it's backed up. That's something that I would take a look at, if you would.
Yeah, no, I'll check into it, but I'm pretty sure the timing's still the same.
Okay, appreciate it. Anybody else? Anything? Yes, sir.
Anything on Amazon?
Unofficially, it was supposed to be open, I think, yesterday or something.
Dude, you're stealing all my planning stuff, man.
Disregard.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Kitko. Appreciate it.
All right, you're welcome. Thank you, Mr. Kitko. And moving on is the planning and zoning update. I'll actually do that. It's very brief. AutoZone will be opening up. I've heard 2 dates. I've heard in a week and then also around Thanksgiving. So in the next couple weeks, AutoZone will be done. So please stop in and do it. They've done a remodel job on the inside and the outside of the building. Which you drive by, you really can't miss their blazing red AutoZone logo. So stop in, say hi to them, welcome them to the city. Speedway, Mr. Kick already said the opening date on that is December 15th. So again, as soon as it's open, stop in and look inside that new store because it's going to be definitely a beautiful store. And moving on, our zoning, just in case anybody has noticed maybe a downfall in our code enforcement activity, our code enforcement gentleman was off for surgery. He just started back last week, so next council meeting, the second one of the month, we'll definitely have a full update on code enforcement activity. And that's all brief I have for the planning and zoning update. So any questions on planning and zoning matters?
There is one from
AutoZone will open Wednesday.
When is it?
Wednesday.
This Wednesday?
From the manager.
We talked to the store manager. It was supposed to open Saturday or Sunday, and I guess they just their software or something wasn't quite ready in the registers and whatnot, so they're going to open Wednesday.
So that's Wednesday the 18th for this week. Okay.
Unless some other bug or something pops up.
Well, he's on the planning and back to Speedway. Just so you know, they, with all the truck traffic that they've had, they are going to restripe our arrows, signal lanes, curbs, things like that. They're going to repaint a lot of that stuff. They paid for the asphalt repair on our main, one main break we had on Church. They paid for stuff like that. So they've been doing their thing because they know that with the mud, they've had to endure, the citizens have had to endure some muddy conditions around there.
Anybody else, any questions at all for planning? Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you. And moving on, our interim fire chief, Ritter, please, with our fire discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mr. Mayor, council, citizens. The New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 103 calls for medical assistance and 11 fire-related calls during the month of October. The division supported the Heritage of Flight Festival and held multiple houses of fire. House for Fire Prevention Month. We've also brought on five firefighter EMT or paramedics who also live in the city. All five individuals living in the city are available for paid per call as well as the part-time program. There are also three additional candidates to be interviewed. The division has also entered into an agreement with Christiansburg Fire Department for an air compressor to be used for refilling self-contained breathing apparatus. This was accomplished with no cost to the city. A grant has been submitted to the Ohio State Fire Marshal's Office for a $50,000 grant for Mark's radios. Mark's radios are what we are going to have in the future. There's no getting around it. Sheriff's Office already uses them. Several departments are already on them. No matching funds are necessary for this grant. Any questions?
Counsel, yes, sir.
I have two. I was under the impression you already had Mark's radios.
We do, but they're not on the same Mark system. This will be the statewide Mark system. Okay. That we have Mark's frequency radios.
Okay. Thank you. Second question. Any progress or anything you can talk about Elizabeth Township? Or is that not what you're talking about for everybody?
Nothing that I only give the reports to them and I don't enter into that.
You're talking in terms of contract. I went to their last meeting, first meeting in November. We've exchanged our concerns, and we'll be moving forward with them here probably. I don't know if it's going to be, if I can attend their November 18th meeting, or it's going to be the first one in December. Mr. Diltz is here from Elizabeth Township, so we've had open communications. I've invited him here today so he can take part of the top three candidate discussion. Since they do contract out with us, I think they should be and absolutely willing to come and offer their input when it comes to this. But we're still going month to month. It's a good relationship. But I think they're just waiting to hold off CLO on this play.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any Anyone else? Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor.
I'm going to go back to the radio question. I know last time when we had to get radios, it was for the Sheriff's Department, I believe, and that was part of a federal mandate that it had to be interoperable with everything else in the world.
It will be coming down to that. But
so this is a federal mandate then, that you have to have these new fancy things?
Yeah, I'm sure it is. It's not like it's going to happen next month, next. It's going to be an ongoing thing. If the city of Springfield and Clark County would have had a meeting of the minds and been able to open the new dispatch center, it probably would have happened a lot sooner, but that's not likely to happen.
But as of right now, the radios we have,
we're operating.
Everybody's safe and
yes,
able to perform their duties.
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you.
Anyone else? Our department, anyone else? Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Moving on with our city manager report, our police discussion with Deputy Allender.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mr. Mayor, Council, citizens. You have a handout that just touches on some of the numbers. I'm just going to hit some of the basics. A total number of reports that were taken for the city last month was 59. Total amount of miles patrolled by a new Carlisle deputy was 1,051. There was a total of 56 calls for service, and that included 7 follow-up investigations. 32 traffic stops were made within the city last month, and that included 16 citations were written. A total of 10 criminal arrests were made, that was including adults and juveniles. And then just kind of a breakdown of that, amongst those arrests or calls for service, there were 2 assaults, 3 break-in and enterings, 11 thefts, which also includes some of our car break-ins, 17 911 hangups, a telephone harassment, 5 domestic violence calls, 2 peace officers, 10 alarms, and 13 assists, which is just assisting another deputy within the city. Basically, some key points that we have is the animals have been removed from 1103 Chestnut, and the Clark County Sheriff's Office Pride Program has cleared up the outside of the property. I know there were some complaints about that. We've been getting a lot of reports of vehicle break-ins in New Carlisle. Again, this just started over the last couple days. And actually, as we speak, they do have 2 suspects in custody, reference those break-ins. They have not been charged with anything relating to the break-ins yet. Right now, the only thing they had them on was they found them living in a vacant house. So they are being taken to jail and held on a burglary charge until the detectives can talk to them tomorrow. We found a number of credit cards and social security number or cards, driver's license that tie back to the vehicles that were broken into. It's just going to take a while to sort that out and who those belong to and tie them to members of the community. But we are working on that. New Carlisle deputies are always patrolling for speeders, and we've recently been focused on the Edgebrook area. There's been a lot of complaints of speeders cutting through the city, you know, going the back way and speeding. And basically that includes patrolling the street itself and sitting stationary, running radar and traffic enforcement on the street. And then just for informational purposes, anywhere from 1 to 20 miles an hour over the speed limit is a cost of $180 fine, which does not include court costs. And that's just kind of an FYI for everybody. Questions?
Council, any questions for the department? Go over here.
To the property on Chestnut, I know the residents around there are really happy that it's been cleaned up. I mean, Mr. Bridge and I have been talking about this for a while now about it, and I did read in the paper, well, online, that one of the dogs that were rescued has now been adopted. So that's a good story for the night.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you for the effort with the entire department on cracking down on some of the break-ins. I know a lot of that's tied to, unfortunately, to heroin abuse and drug abuse that we have, and it's not just a New Carlisle thing, this is everywhere. Let's say I'm a resident and I've got some old prescription medication in my house. I mean, this is how people end up hooked on the opioids and they go to the heroin. So I've got sole prescription medication, I don't know what to do with it. I've got half a mind to flush it down the toilet. What should I do with it?
We do a drug take back program, which that's offered, I believe New Carlisle had one recently. They also offer them in a lot of the townships. Moorefield Township always does one, Enon does one. But you can also take those medications to a pharmacy. They have a way of disposing of those medications, you know, so that way kids or family member, they don't end up stolen. But, you know, and if anybody ever has any questions or is unsure of how to go about it, they can always call us and we can direct them to the right place.
Okay, so either a pharmacy or calling the non-emergency line of the sheriff's
department. Correct. But yeah, pharmacies will always accept it. And then, like I said, with the take-back or the drug take-back vans, those usually only occur, I think, once or twice a year. But if they don't want to wait that long, then yeah, they can contact us or just take them to the local pharmacy.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Yes. I'll just go back to your 1 to 20 miles per hour. And since we got a lot of young people here, do they have to go to court?
A speed violation is not a mandatory court appearance unless you're a juvenile. Anything over 20 miles out an hour is considered a reckless op complaint, so it is a mandatory court appearance. But anything from 1 to 20 is not mandatory, it's just a fee required.
Two within a year is a mandatory court appearance.
Correct.
Two within a year?
How do you know that?
Personal experience.
I know all the time.
I think we both know that.
Anyone else? Council, anyone? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Council,
I need to have somebody forfeit one of their police reports for my records. Anybody want to get one up?
Thank you. Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Sure. Dick says he's retiring.
Yeah, he doesn't.
There's more on the table back there if anybody wants one.
Okay. If you go on, please.
Sure. And moving on to the city manager report, we got some informational items. Attached to the packet is a new Carlisle House health stats. Take a minute, look over those if you're interested in those. Sad announcements. The last meeting for our current councilman, Dick Zambach over there, will be December 7th. So the next council meeting, please come in attendance and give him thanks for all the many years of service that he has put this city first. We appreciate all your time and effort, and I am personally going to miss you. So please come back and visit us, but we'll get to all the good details at the next council meeting. Sure. And moving on, it says work session that we need to schedule, but I think it needs to be more of a special meeting. There may be an ordinance that we would have to pass, but the gist of it is going to be to talk about the police budget. I mean, not budget, but the actual cost of if we want to do three or four deputies.
Right.
You know, so I am requesting that date be set today. We do have availability for the 18th or 19th, which is Wednesday or Thursday of this week.
What does council desire? Wednesday or Thursday of this week?
I can't do either.
Can't do either?
I can do Thursday.
Thursday so far?
Wednesday.
Thursday.
Wednesday.
Wednesday. I can't do Wednesday.
I can do Wednesday if you have to.
I can do my best to make either one on Wednesday is my problem.
Dare I recommend a Friday evening one if Mr. McIntyre?
That's acceptable.
Of course, you're in our week.
Yeah, perfect. Where am I then? You do know we actually have an extra week before we have the next council meeting in December.
So has nothing to do with that.
It doesn't?
We had a time element on that.
Yeah.
Time issue.
What time? How they were in the coffee?
I'm sorry?
What time?
Oh, that's between you guys.
Are we looking at a 2-hour meeting? Is that what we're looking at?
We've got to talk about the cops, and then if it comes down to our health insurance ordinance for employees, that's not going to be much discussion about that because we have to pass it. So I wouldn't say it's going to take more than maybe an hour. Depends on how deep you want to go into the cop discussion.
I'm on Tuesday. Oh, I mean, the 24-hour. Yeah,
we got to give them notice.
Yeah, that sounds right.
And then the ordinance would have to be passed as emergencies. So we're going to need at least six of them there.
Did you say Wednesday or Thursday?
Or Friday.
No, but Thursday's bad.
Probably. Well, Mr. McIntyre can't be there Thursday.
Doesn't it have to be
Wednesday, Wednesday?
Well, yeah, we got time to announce it. Oh, yeah, we got 24 hours, so we need
to. Probably come at 6 o'clock.
Well, if it's 6:30, I can do it better.
6:30, Wednesday work for you?
Yeah, because I got to do the kitchen.
Wednesday, 6:30?
Well, you got to have help, though, from the road.
Yeah, that's true.
That's true. You got all kinds of help.
That's true.
We'll talk about that tomorrow. Mr. City Manager?
No, we won't do it. You can't do 30.
Seems like you're ignoring me again.
We're going to close out.
Sure.
Beans over here.
It seems that you said Wednesday, correct? 6:30?
Yeah.
Wednesday? 6:30, Mr. McIntyre.
And we have six.
We're not able to come with the rest of them.
Well, so we'll have six council members there with the exception of Mr.
Right.
McIntyre.
Mr. McIntyre.
Okay. So the 18th, 6:30.
6:30 here, is that correct?
It'll be here.
And we're looking at approximately an hour and a half. It is an open meeting. Anyone can come if they wish.
I'll work tomorrow to get you covered.
Appreciate it.
Is it too late to get into Carlisle News? Is it too late to get that into the Carlisle News?
Can we get that in? So we can get it in the paper tomorrow? I mean, by all.
Well, that's still not 24-hour notice.
Well, we are getting notice now.
Yeah, sorry.
We can do Springfield.
Yeah, we can do Springfield.
And you can put it on the website.
That doesn't satisfy by the. That satisfies me.
I think that does satisfy.
Hey, so are we all set?
And we're making an announcement tonight. I think it does satisfy.
So we're all set with the date then?
To this one.
6:30 Wednesday, here. So you'll figure out what paper and so forth. We're gonna call it a special meeting now.
It is a special meeting.
Not a work session.
Could you once again reiterate what the topics will be, so when they make a motion, we can?
It will be to discuss the police numbers that I sent out to council. And there'll also be to possibly discuss the ordinance for employee health insurance.
We need a.
Possibly, or we are?
Again, we don't know yet, so it's gonna be a possible. Still waiting to hear back from the insurance.
So we need a motion, please, council.
Second.
Mr. Zambach moved. Second who?
Ethan.
Mr. Reynolds, second.
Hang on, I gotta write this down.
Okay. Are you ready, sir?
Give me a minute.
All right. I threw a wrench into your meeting.
I could think you could. You can fill.
Is this health insurance?
I think you could vote for it, but I mean, it's your personal preference. This is from my understanding of.
Who made that motion?
Mr. Zambach.
Zambach made it. Mr. Reynolds, second.
I would personally vote to abstain, but it's your choice.
Here's what I have to tell me.
I don't wanna say one.
Okay, sir.
Motion to conduct special meeting on Wednesday, 11/18/15, at 6:30 p.m. to discuss police financial numbers and possible employees' health insurance.
Correct.
That mean?
All right.
That worked.
Sounds good to me. Okay. Any questions?
That's fine.
Mr. Rick Lowery.
Yes.
Mr. Kraybach.
Yes.
Mr. Mike Lowery.
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Although I won't be able to be there, it's for the good of the city that we have it, so yes.
Okay. Mr. Zambach.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Pass 7-0 for the special meeting on Wednesday at 6:30 p.m.
Thank you, sir. Would you like to continue?
Sure. And I do believe that's all we have for the city manager's report, so I'll entertain any questions.
Any questions for the city manager? Love to hear. Anyone? Council. It's like you have done a wonderful job.
That's the goal.
So now we will continue on. We are at the comments from members of the public. Anyone from the public like to speak this evening on any issues, please? So, go up to the podium. Anyone at all? Go to the podium, sir. Identify yourself.
Okay.
Would you go to the podium and identify yourself? Speak on what you wish, please.
I'd rather not identify myself.
You're gonna have to, Ron.
Ron Manaman, 311 North Adams Street. I come here mainly tonight to give thanks and appreciation for a fine man that is still acting on our fire department. Even though he had very close call just very recently. We owe a thank you, a much thank you, to our assistant chief, Rick Ritter. Rick, I thank you for your recovery. You are a miracle. And as you well know, and as Ron Grout well knows, and any medic in this house knows you should not be here. But I always say, when you come back, the Lord's not ready for you and the devil don't want you.
I'm sure of that. Thank you.
My thank you to you for being with us still.
That deserves a applause. Thank you for bringing that to our attention. Anyone else? Anyone else like to speak this evening? Okay, we will continue on. Committee reports, are there any committee reports tonight? None? All right, well now, resolutions, we have none. We'll go into ordinances, please.
15-47, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to submit consent to the Ohio Department of Transportation for a micro-servicing project located within the city of New Carlisle.
Mr. Mayor. Yes, sir.
Motion to adopt ordinance 15-47.
Second.
Mr. Craig Walker, second.
And an explanation of this ordinance, this is just going to allow ODOT to come in and, you know, they put a slurry mix on the road. It just helps preserve it, give it an extended life. So basically give them permission to come in and do it in our city limits.
Any questions at all, council? Questions? Would you call for the vote, please?
Mr. Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Zambach?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Craig?
Yes.
Pass 7-0.
Thank you, sir. When you're ready, if you would read the rest of them, please. They'll leave introductions.
All introductions. Ordinance 15-48, introduction, public hearing in action on 12-7-15. An ordinance amending the estimated resources of the city of New Carlisle to the Clark County Auditor that will be available to appropriate for the fiscal year beginning January 1, 2015. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Ordinance 15-49, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 12-7-15. An ordinance supplementing certain appropriations in ordinance 15-11E of the city of New Carlisle. Ordinance 15-50, introduction, public hearing in action on 12-7-15. An ordinance establishing temporary appropriations for fiscal year 2016. Ordinance 15-51, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 12-7-15. An ordinance of the city of New Carlisle, Ohio, amending the disconnection reconnection fees, Appendix A of Ordinance 13-07, correcting Shrivener's errors and providing for inclusion in the codified ordinances.
Thank you, sir. Now we're into other business. Other business, council? Anything? Nothing? I have an update for everybody on the sign at Smith Park. Sign at Smith Park, talking about the one that says Welcome to Smith Park, has now been completed.
Yeah, good job.
Thank you. Just want to let everybody know that the Hatcher family donated $350 for Sign Smith, which was actually Studio 10, to be able to do the center portion of it. And we put that up today. Looks very nice now. And so we will forge forward. I want to thank Mr. Bill Morrow for the help on it as well. And hopefully it stays looking as pristine as it does now for a few years. So anybody out in the audience have anything under business at this time? Like to speak on?
Mayor, I thought the sign was going to be white.
It was white for a while. Thank you. Nope. Thanks for bringing that up.
Thank you.
Nobody else knows it.
That's an inside joke.
Nobody else got it.
I got it. I got it.
Council, no one else? Other business? Okay. Would you go ahead and read the other things that we have?
Yes, city offices will be closed. The holiday seasons are upon us. City office will be closed on Thanksgiving Day, Thursday, November 26th, and Friday, November 27th. City offices will be closed on Christmas Eve, Thursday, December 24th, Christmas Day, Friday, December 25th, and New Year's Day, Friday, January 1st, 2016. Crime-wise, there'll be no meeting in December. The meetings will resume in January of 2016. Santa's arrival, Saturday, December 5th, 9:30 a.m. at the Andy Barnhart Memorial Airport, and as Marshall had mentioned, everyone is welcome. Christmas parade the same morning, Saturday, December the 5th at 10 a.m. starting on Main Street. Christmas tree lighting ceremony, Saturday, December 5th, 6:30 p.m. downtown New Carlisle. And as it's mentioned, we will have the meet and greet with the top three administrator chief candidates here in a few minutes.
Hey, I do have a question for the fire department. As far as the parade ending up there, are you going to be handing out candy and so forth to the kids that are there? Would you like to have some donations?
Actually, we had enough candy left over from Halloween that we've given it to Marshall, and they're going to hand it out during the parade. I think he told me the other day they have sufficient candy.
Okay, thank you.
But I'd check with him, make sure.
Appreciate that. The meet and greet and questions and so forth, should we just go ahead and do executive session? There's none this evening. And we would get into that, I believe.
I think city manager has one more.
Yes, as we know, Christmas time is coming up, and December 18th, we have elected to have our employee Christmas party here at the Shelter House. We'll begin at noon. I would like permission to close the city offices at noon for that day so everybody can come, including council and anyone else in the room.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes,
sir. Make a motion to close city offices December 18th.
Second.
Who was first?
Second.
Hey, you go, McIntyre.
Robert.
I'm going to change my voice, Bill.
Mr. Rick Lauer.
Yes.
Mr. Craybar.
Yes.
Mr. Mike Lauer.
Yes.
Mayor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Zambach.
Well, I'm not going to vote for this next year, but I will this year.
Okay.
Is
that a yes? Is that a yes?
Yes.
I would ask that.
Yes.
Council, if you can make that.
You're remarkable. Yes.
I beg your pardon. I need to step in between.
How much money are you going to hit up for this year when we get here?
I don't know yet. We'll see. I'll surprise you.
Didn't somebody bring a 50 last year and put it in like a
couple
bowl?
Bucks.
Yeah, you can get me up that.
You said that.
Okay.
What I was asking is if you can get, if you're going to be in town, if you're here, could you please come to that, the luncheon room? City employees, I think that'd be good if more of us could make it. I think last year, Mr. Lowry and I were the only two that made it, if I remember correctly. So if you could, please, if you could make it, that would be good. Even you, Mr. Zambach, would be nice if you make it.
I'm writing that down.
Thank you, sir. Well, are we ready to do the meet and greet?
I'm ready to go. Do you just want to get into it? Should we have the gentleman move so everybody can see him? Is everybody okay with where they're at, or? What do you think?
Well, should we ask them to go one by one to identify themselves?
And I'm talking about placement where they're sitting. Is everybody okay with that?
I think we can see everybody fine.
Sure.
It would be easy for me if they go to the podium. Oh. Identify themselves.
That would be a good idea, thank you. Could we ask each one of you to go to the podium, identify yourself, tell us a little bit about yourself, and you'll take questions in from the audience and from council at PD. And I think we'll start with you, sir, the first gentleman there. You go up to the podium, identify yourself.
Good evening. Thank you for this opportunity. My name is Joe Stalder. I was in the fire service in Moorefield Township from December 1968 to about 38 years total. At that time, I was fire chief. During those years, I did all the, I had a lot of people tell me, why are you so active in all these, the arson task force and the hazmat tech? And I said, well, to be a chief, you need to know everything about the fire service. So that's the reason I had just about all the certifications that you could have in the fire service during those years. I technically retired after 38 years, but I still teach at Clark State. I've been an instructor there for GBS. About in 1981, 82, I started teaching, and I still teach at Clark State. So I'm still involved in the fire service, still keep up on the laws and everything that our fire chief needs to do. During all those years, I had my own business. I had Stalders Cafeteria and Catering Service with my parents. We had also food trailers that we did the Clark County Flea Market. We worked with Bruce Knight out there for about 30 years. So I had the experience of owning my own business with my parents. During that time, in 1990, I went to work for the State Fire Marshal's Office. I was the underground storage tank inspector that would have been at the site up here at your new station putting the tanks in. And I was appointed fire chief in 1990. And in 1993, I started the first part-time program in Clark County. And then it started to get a little tough for me with home and work and so forth. So the trustees offered me a full-time job. So I was the first full-time fire chief in Clark County. And then after that, I went to Navistar, and I was in loss prevention. I still was working in EMS. I was the fire instructor down there for all the hazmat and all the fire extinguisher training that I did down there in the plant protection. That's about it in a nutshell. Any questions?
Yes, sir, I'm sure. Council, any questions from council?
Do you want to do them one by one, or do you just want them to introduce and then
a group question type
group question.
Yeah. Let's introduce first.
You want to introduce each first and then?
Are you okay with that? Mr. Mayor?
That would be fine.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Clark.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. My name is Ron Grout. Privileged to be standing up here tonight. In the past, I have served as the chief of the fire department from 03 to 2010. Served as assistant chief from 88 until 2003. When I first took on the position of chief with the fire division, we had some big challenges, far worse challenges then than what we do now. We had broken apparatus. We were on state fiscal emergency. We had poor response times. As a team, we addressed those issues. We put the department back together. We formulated a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week program, created the Elizabeth Township contract, which aided our neighbors and also aided us in additional revenue. Full-time, I am a realtor for Berkshire Hathaway. Previous to that, I was the executive director for the Medical Transportation Board for the state of Ohio for 13 years. I've written a lot of legislation, very familiar with Ohio law, and I still love EMS and fire, and I hate that fly. But
was over here, Ron. I'm glad it's over here.
Well, you know, he keeps coming over there and over here, so I don't know. I know all the candidates. Joe and I go back a long time. Joe's a great guy. You have three great candidates, and quite frankly, whoever you pick is going to do a good job. Thanks.
Thanks, Ron.
Good evening, my name is Steve Trusty. Currently, I'm a lieutenant with the division, also the one of the inspectors, and also the division chaplain. Started my career in fire service in 1977 at the Kaiser High School in the city of Dayton. Graduated high school with a paid firefighter certification through the city of Dayton. Spent 6 years in the Marine Corps after that, was attached to the fire base squadrons in Beaufort, South Carolina. The entire time that I was in the Marine Corps, I was also a volunteer with the fire department out in town and also a volunteer with the voluntary mess system. After honorably discharged from the Marine Corps in 83, I became a full-time paid firefighter at the same base, Marine Corps Air Station Beaufort, and I was there from 83 till 88 when I transferred back to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, coming back home so my kids could be around their grandparents. Stayed there until my retirement in 2014. Retired there as a firefighter inspector investigator. During my tenure there, I gained the rank of lieutenant and then was promoted as an inspection division. So total, I've been in the fire service for approximately almost 42 years. I've been a certified EMT for 34 years in the state of South Carolina and state of Ohio. I was also a instructor for the State Fire Academy in South Carolina for all three phases of rookie school. I'm also a certified state inspector for the state of Ohio. I have several certifications that I've gained through the federal government and state, everything from fire officer schools to IC schools to hazmat tech entry team, combined space entry team, trench rescue entry team, several different certifications. This has been my passion from the time I was 17 years old. I love doing the job. I love the, it's just what I want to do. At this time, I have no other obligations as far as a job. I'm retired, so I'm able to commit 24/7 to the division as I do now, part-time paid and on call. And that's about it.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Hey. What do you want to ask a question? Like individual citizens, you must ask a question. Let's go to the podium.
You want them to go to the podium with individual citizen?
Ask a question. So we know who asked it. Who's not to see it.
Shall we have council first ask a question if they'd like?
Totally up to you.
Council, is there someone you'd like to go back up to the podium and ask a question? Mr. McIntyre?
I have a group question. May I ask that?
You have a group?
Yes.
Are all over there? Yes.
Going through the resumes, it looks like everyone has had a lot of managerial experience, have been in charge of employees and departments in different situations. Part of getting better as a person is we learn from our mistakes and we grow and we use failures in order to build ourselves up to be even better. So my question for each of the candidates is, in your work experience, did you ever have a conflict or a disagreement with an employee that you wish you could have handled differently or handled better? And how could you have handled that better? What did you learn from that experience that said, I could have done this or that differently in order to better rectify the situation or take care of the situation? So that's essentially my question. How did you learn and grow from some of the interactions you wish you could have handled differently?
Dealing with different organizations, I've dealt with fire service plus also military and paramilitary organizations. I also belonged to the, at one time, with the Young Marines program, which was for almost 10 years. And dealing with parents and dealing with individuals and subordinates. Biggest thing I learned was, one, make sure you have all the facts before you speak. And one of the biggest thing also is when you're dealing with a conflict, make sure that you praise in public and correct in private. And make sure what you have is very transparent.
Thank you.
Anyone else like to answer that question?
I'd be glad to. Sure. One of the things that I learned early in my career was I ran a non-union shop, had about 300 employees. That union shop attempted to unionize about five times. I made a critical mistake at one point and made an inquiry to an employee that I didn't realize I was making an inquiry. But it resulted in me writing a personal letter of a recommendation for his new job. I took that to heart, and when I said personal, I literally sat down with an ink pen and wrote it, which I could have used a computer, but I didn't. I wanted him to know that while I did violate the law, that I learned something from that experience. And he thought he was doing the right thing, I thought I was doing the right thing, and both of us. Good lesson.
Thank you.
I think over the years with owning my own business and the fire service is, in my case, the fire service, I depend on a lot of my officers. And first, you have a chain of command and you try to get all the information. And sometimes, just like Ron said, you get the wrong information and probably didn't investigate. I took heed to what the captain was telling me. I felt that he did a thorough investigation, and it didn't turn out that way. And what I learned is, even though I have officers, I still need to follow up and to make sure, you know, that doesn't happen again.
Thank you, sir. Yes.
As fire chiefs, what is, other than financial, because obviously in a small fire department, finances are always probably a challenge in their own. Other than finances, what are some of the biggest challenges, or number one challenge, as a fire chief faces in a department our size?
Well, I would,
in your opinion,
manpower today, the training, and the men and women that wants to dedicate it is not like it was in 1968. It was all volunteers back then. Because of the amount of runs that we had to go to part-time, I think the biggest frustration is to keep the people trained and keep up with the dollar value, because obviously this township might be paying $18, this township might be $20, and obviously they're going to go, and you have a constant turnover. And I think that would be one of the problems that you would have being fire chief.
Thank you.
I think it's a growing, as Joe just said, this is a growing problem for every chief, is keeping that staffing, trying to get young people to look into the fire service. I think that we need to reach out to youth. One of the things in speaking with the city manager some time back was bridging the gap between our Hispanic community and seeing what we might be able to do to make them part of the solution. And both of those are going to be pretty big obstacles and pretty big challenges, because a lot of youth have a lot of things going on in their lives, and getting them into the department again, getting excited about the department, like Steve did, like I did when I was 17, 18 years old. It's going to take some work, and it's going to take some patience. But I see that's the biggest challenge for the future.
Okay. I agree. One, as both gentlemen said, training and upkeeping that level of training and level of certification, because he said back early in the years, it wasn't mandated as much as it is now by the state of what every firefighter is required to have and what every firefighter is required to maintain every year, every 2 years for their recertification, fire and EMS. And that's, to me, that is one of the biggest challenges any fire chief is going to have, especially in a small department like this, is getting that manpower and getting the youth in, yes, but also retaining them. You know, it's easy to get them in the door and say, hey, let's, you know, the glory of lights and siren and being the macho fireman is there, but then that retention of keeping them there, and not only keeping them there to get them trained, but also keeping them after they're trained so that they don't say, okay, I got my training, I'm good to go, I'm going down the street to the paid fire department where I can make a lot more money. Keeping that retention back to us, whether they may make that step into full-time fire service, being able to stay with us also, a lot of our department right now, a lot of our people are full-time career firefighters at other departments, that this is a part-time job for them. Keeping that retention is a very big, big obstacle, and I think that's one of the things fire chief is going to really have to look at.
Thank you.
Yes, sir, Mr. Graybottom.
Okay, now all three of you said a magic word, retention. How would you do that, you know, knowing that our budget restraints, you know, and without raising the pay? How could you do that?
Well, that's a very big task. I think the only thing you could do is have everything in place as far as let the firefighters, EMS, know what the rules and regulations are, what the policies and procedures are. This is the way we're going to do it. And this is the way we're going to do it, hopefully to keep everybody and keep everybody safe.
Well, keep everybody safe, I get up and move everything right now.
Yeah, that's not very good.
No, it is. It's a little too good right now.
We're the fire inspector.
Yeah, the
Sorry about the interruption.
Oh, that's all right. We're going to stay safe.
It's getting a little warm in here for me. But I'll make that off
the age. The one of the things was, get ready to say, is to do on all that, you're doing it for the safety of the firefighters. And I think that they know that, okay, this is all I'm going to get. I know this, but, you know, we're trying to do this. We're getting the equipment as the finances see it. We're updating the equipment as the finances see it. The chief is trying to make some changes. I think they're going to retain some of those firefighters.
Yeah. Well, it when it comes to keeping things status quo with regards to not increasing our budgets, we can do that short term, quite frankly. But I also got to be realistic. The gap for our current firefighters and paramedics is becoming wider and wider against the township departments. So we have to be cognizant of that. But when I was chief during 03 to 10, the biggest thing is people were treated fairly, and they were treated like they were needed and welcomed, and treated with respect. That's the best I can do.
Rearing on what Ron said, yeah, it's the pay, that is something that's going to probably have to be looked at down the line. That's just facts. But also, too, listening to the firefighters. Sometimes it's not the pay that the firefighter's looking at. Sometimes retention is just a fact of, use me. Our department has the capabilities with so many, as I said before, with so many of our firefighters being career firefighters at other departments, we have so much talent and so much skill that is untapped in the department that a lot of times just asking that firefighter, that paramedic, hey, could you do this or could you teach this or could you help with this, gives them that little bit of, hey, self-confidence, gives them that little bit of pride to stay there because they're helping that young kid coming in the door and teaching them from what they need to know. And a lot of times, someone's going to stay just so they can teach. No one came into this job, in this profession, to be a millionaire. No one did. Okay, the only reason you're in this job is because you want to be. Okay, no one wants to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to go out and, you know, pull somebody out of a car. You're there because you want to be. And a lot of times our firefighters and our paramedics are there and they'd be happy to walk up and say, hey, I'll teach that class. And a lot of times your retention comes from that, pride.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Council, anyone else? Any other questions? Anyone? Yes, go ahead.
I have a question for each of you. Joe, will you work closely with Elizabeth Township in the coming, because we do contract with them, and I don't know if you'd be willing to go to like a few of their meetings and work closely with them, yes, because they help keep this department running.
Yes. I applied 2 years ago, and I was aware of that, and yes, I'd be willing to work with other townships.
Mr. Grout, you had said that you had initiated the original contract with Elizabeth Township.
I did.
Do you think that's something that you want to maintain in the future?
Absolutely. Yeah, very much so. We've had a great working relationship with Elizabeth Township. They're good people, and there are a lot of good neighbors out in Elizabeth Township that this department has made a difference, as whether they're today or they're there now and not. We feel like that is our community also. And Elizabeth Township has been very kind to us and given us a great station to work out of. We kind of get picked on every once in a while because there's not a lot of calls out there. But the truth of the matter is, when there is a call out there, you can better bet you it's going to be something that's going to amount to life or death. Don't have too many frequent
calls. And Mr. Trustee, my question to you is, you said to correct them in private. During several meetings during this year, you've come here to council and you had criticized fellow firefighters for the way they had handled the issue with our previous chief. Do you think that if we were to select you, you could bridge that gap with those members that you had publicly criticized?
Yes, I do. Already have.
All right, just want to make sure.
Okay, council, any other questions? Anyone?
I got one.
Okay, great.
I was kind of wanting to go on the
similar question to Ethan. When you have a situation, this is for all three of you, when you have, you know, a situation like we had in our firehouse over the past year or so, can each and every one of you, I don't know how to word this the right way, can you take a firehouse that's divided and fix it? I know that's a loaded question, but my biggest concern is with a couple of candidates is if we put one or the other, it's going to go back to the Senate. And I know this is a big question, but if we put one or two of the candidates in there, I personally feel, is it going to divide the firehouse? And if it does, can it be fixed? And I'm going to leave that to Steve and to Ron's question, actually.
To me?
Yes, sir.
Do I feel I can bridge that gap? Yes, I do. I feel that we've learned a lot of lessons and learned a lot of facts. And I feel that working together, the biggest thing I feel is communication. If you don't have communication, it's not going to work. And I feel that goes from top to bottom, bottom to top.
Okay.
Is that all three of them?
That was for Ron, if Ron wanted to chime in on it.
Oh, absolutely, I'd love to. The members of the department, we're all here for the same reason. The biggest thing I want to do is, no looking back, let's go forward. The issues are what they were. Rehashing those, we don't need to do that. The members of the department that were most dramatic have already removed themselves from this division by themselves without any prompting at all. To the best of my knowledge, this division is getting along with each other very well. And I think that's evident by the folks that are here tonight. I don't think that anybody sitting at this table solicited these folks to show up. They came because they're interested in seeing what's going to happen.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else from council, please? Hi, Mr. Craybaugh.
Thank you. Everybody has different leadership styles. You know, some people are mild-mannered, some people are hard-nosed, some people are just in the middle of the road, you know, peacemakers, et cetera. Can you describe what is your leadership style? And, you know, Steve, you know what you have just come through. You know, you know what the previous administrator had. You know, how can you, you know, what is your leadership style and what can you do to bring better leadership to the fire department?
I feel that, first of all, and I've said this 100 times over the years with us, Chief, that that's what we're here for. We're here for the residents. We're here to save lives and help to take part. And I think a lot of times we get off that beaten path. And I think sometimes this is where the chief has to come in and if it's low key or high key, I mean, it's like anything. You say so much so many times and it's still not getting through or you're still not getting done. Obviously, we're all human. We're going to take so much that some of us might blow, some of us not. Again, just like we were talking earlier, there's a time and place for that. Obviously, you don't get on the scene, you wait to get back to the station, and you sit down and talk at that point. And you go on one-on-one basis or go through your officers, however it is. But my leadership is, this is the policy procedures. This is what I expect us to do. And if we don't do that, then we got to sit down and figure out what we can do. What I say is not land of law. I mean, we're on this together. I want your input, and I use officers and firefighters to give me feedback. Because that's what Ron or the other gentleman said earlier, it's all about communications and communication with firefighters.
Lead by example. It's huge. Previously, when I left the department, I had 61 members. I think that we had one of the lowest turnover rates of our membership in a five-year period. Why? Because we were treating each other with respect, and it didn't matter whether you were the chief or you knew this person on the department. We did duty shifts together. We participated in daily cleanups. This is not a huge department. So when it's 6 o'clock in the morning and there's station duties to be done, that includes the chief also. And I think by leading by example and being there and associating with the members, it goes a long way. It really does.
Talking about as far as leadership types, to me, again, it's one of those things, as Ron said, I said before, communication. And that means communication from the newest rookie coming in the door up to the assistant chiefs. And it's any fire chief has to walk a really fine line of knowing that the buck does stop with him. He has he's the one that everything's going to be answered to him at the end. But he also has to rely on who's under him. Any good leader knows he's only as good as his people that's under him. And if you ever lose that respect, and to me, respect is not demanded or because you have five bugles on your collar, that respect is there, that respect is earned. And you never, and I agree with Ron, with the military and being an NCO, being in charge of different things, in the fire service, being an officer, that thing of never asking someone to do something that I won't go out there and do with them. But also, a fire chief can never, ever give the impression that someone else is running his department. And that's where that fine line of being there with everyone in the department, but also knowing that the buck stops with you, you're the last one in line, you got to answer the hard questions. And being able to walk that line. And sometimes it's hard. And sometimes hard decisions have to be made. But I also feel that a fire chief, any good fire chief, will solicit from his officers before he makes any decisions.
Can I do one more?
Go ahead.
One of the complaints was from about the previous fire chief was that he was not approachable, that it could not come to him. Do you feel like that you are approachable, and how do you exert that amongst the people that you are approachable?
I'm very approachable with anyone in the department. One position that I hold in the department is department chaplain. So I have to be very approachable. And most people, that anyone that knows me in the department knows that they can come and ask me anything, and they may not like the answer, but I will be honest with them. I'm not going to sugarcoat it, and I'm not going to blow them off. I will answer anything at any time. I've had firefighters call me at home, hey, not just fire department questions, but other things in their life that, hey, can we talk? Sure.
Day and age of cellulars, I mean, communication is very easy to be made. And anybody that knows me and been part of the department knows that I'm fairly easy to get a hold of. Probably the worst thing is getting me off the phone once you get me on there, because I tend to talk a lot. But getting to know the individuals, them knowing that when a trouble does happen, that they can call me and we're going to deal with it. Bad things do happen. And not overreacting to that. You know, as Joe said, you know, we all fell victim to that over time, where things happen and you get one side of the story. You as council members the very same way. And you sometimes have to revisit it. And sometimes that means swallowing your pride. And been there, done that.
I consider myself a people person. I'm very outgoing. At the same time, I listen. I'm the same way. I've got phone calls 2 to 3, 4 o'clock in the morning. Especially when I was working the state, I think I was getting a call every other hour when I was working the state for a losing child. Then everybody was calling instead of handling the problem. But all you have to do is communicate that you're available at any time you have a problem. Yes, we have a chain of command, but if you don't feel you can talk to your lieutenant or captain, absolutely, you can come and talk to me at any time you want to.
Council, anybody else over here? This side?
One more.
Go ahead, sir.
This will be for all three of you. If one of you were to be picked, how long do you see yourself in this position if hired? I mean, for your personal
how far do you plan to take this ride if you were to get the job?
First part, I was on for 30 years. I'm back on right now. And as long as the good Lord's will and my body's able to do it, I plan on doing it for quite a while.
I feel I'm in good health. I just had a good exam about 3 months ago, good health. Probably realistic 5-10 years. So like I said, I've been in for over 40 years. And this is the reason I want to continue. This, I feel this is my calling.
Like I said, I've already ended one career with Wright-Patter Force Base, so as long as the good Lord lets me, and as long as you, as the citizens, you keep me. I have no plans to leave the area. I have no plans to, I'm not looking as a, this is a stepping stone to something greater or better. To me, this is great for me, as long as I can be here.
Thank you.
Council, anybody else?
No. I just like to say thank all of you. I'm not going to answer your questions because I have 3 questions and all of them was asked before we got here. I want to thank you all for being here and answering
questions. Thank you.
All right. Council has no more questions to vote. Before I turn it over to the audience, we'd like to take a 5-minute break. If the students would like to let you get signed, you can do that at that point. So let's take a 5-minute break. Then we're going to let the audience ask questions at that point. Everybody, 5 minutes, please. Get out here this evening. All right, we're going to open it up now to anyone in the audience. They would like, if you raise your hand, or if you could go up to the podium, if you would, Mr. Cobb, if you'd like to go up to the podium.
Hello, my name?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes.
My name is Ronald Cobb, 202 Bella Drive. My question, gentlemen, one, where is your goals going to be with this department, and what are going to be your priorities to the department and the city?
Well, my goal is to, when I first come in, first, obviously, I don't like to use this word, but outsider, but I have lived in Clark County all my life, so I'm not really an outsider. But not knowing everything that's going on the last year and a half, 2 years, my goal is to train and conduct a well-trained, well-run fire department that could go out and do what we're supposed to do, take care of lives and protect property. Is there a two-part on that? Or?
I just wonder what your goal and what your priorities will be if you are selected, because the reason I say that, if we have trouble getting the second medic out. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, we used Bethel quite a few times, and Bethel's made runs in here, Pike Township.
Right.
You know what I'm talking about, Rick. And that's what I want to know is, where is the priority going to lay as far as the citizens of this community?
Well, here again, if you have the manpower, and I was just talking to someone who said they have trouble getting people to come for the second run or maybe a structure fire, I don't know. Do you have 2 medics? So you have 2 medic units, you know, maybe my goal would be to get the people involved and to get more involved on the second run. And because we're here to take care of the residents. If we can't, then we keep going to townships and we're completing their area.
Yeah, I mean, I'm with you. I mean, the second calls occur. To give the department members a break, this department is getting pounded with regards to calls. And it isn't a day that doesn't go by that they're not looking at, you know, at least 5 calls as an effort. One of the things I think we're going to have to do is, yes, we want to get the paid per call individuals active and participating. But we may have to do something creative and try to do it with very limited funds. Perhaps look at our neighbors down the road and seeing if we can share a medic unit. In other words, half-time ours, half-time theirs, put them together and make it work. And that way we get the response times where they need to be and maybe perhaps split it 50-50 between the communities where it's at. If we've got them in-house, we can get them rolling, we can get them there pretty quick.
looking at it and seeing what we've already been doing and what we're doing now, and I agree with you how getting that second medic out on medic runs, because we have had several runs since where we are getting slammed, that second medic coming in. One of my long-term goals, I say long-term, I don't mean 20 years from now, 10 years from now, as soon as possible. What I would like to see is for us to continue with our battalion program as is, having that battalion on duty, but also bringing on a third person on that shift in the city. That way that battalion officer can drop, or battalion person can drop off the battalion, go with that third person, take that second medic run, and that way it comes right out of the house right then, not waiting. And also too, with that system would also give us the abilities and capabilities on a fire run to have four people on the scene right away.
I won't get into further discussion on that.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else? You'd like to go up to the podium if you have a question? Anyone? Go ahead, sir. Oh, we have somebody else. Go ahead, sir.
Greg Dills from Elizabeth Township. I do have one question there, a couple questions.
Sir, are you currently in the fire department?
He's a township trustee.
I'm sorry.
Actually, your question is yes. Troy Fire Department.
He's a township trustee.
Yes. Okay,
yes. Why do you guys want to be, and if this is appropriate, why do you guys want to be the new Carlisle Fire Chief? And what makes you stand out better than your opponent? It's blank of the job.
Well, the reason I want to be a fire chief in for this area is to meet the challenge that is in front of me. And it sounds like it's going to be a pretty good challenge. Everybody asks why. You've had 40 years, you're retired, you know, why you want this headache? My wife asks me that every day, but it's in my blood, and this is what I. This is what I want to do. I bring to the table the people skills and the training background and expertise I have to be a good fire chief.
Thanks for the question. Quite frankly, between the two departments and being with them for as long as I have. I wouldn't have left in 2010, but I thought it was for the best interest of the department. My wife had thyroid cancer and I had to have back surgery. At that time, my life was, personally, I had to make a decision. Things are good. And knowing that creating the Elizabeth Township Station, in the very beginning and how well that's went, we were out to solve a problem. And within the community, same thing. There's always going to be problems. There's going to be a guy that's got to come up with those solutions, and I'm about making those solutions.
I want to be the fire chief because I love this department. I think it's a fantastic place to work. I think the city is fantastic. I feel that I do have the knowledge. I have the training. I have the experience. I do have the people skills. As far as Elizabeth Township, I think it's a fantastic program. It's a beautiful, beautiful house, beautiful station. And I think that's one of the assets for the department.
Thank you. Anybody else? Go ahead, man. Go up to the podium, please, if you would. Thank you.
My name is Nancy Lubanovich. I live at 505 Pease Drive. And I'd like to get one word answers to this question. When you look at an applicant, what's the most important quality you're looking for?
Honesty.
I think number one is honesty and obviously the background.
Okay, and then when they look at you, what are they looking for as the most important?
Leadership and integrity, I hope.
And they can trust you.
I don't know how they're going to choose. I'm glad I don't have to.
Thank you. Mr. Madden, would you like to go up now, please? Show your hand.
I suppose you wonder why I'm here. Gentlemen, thank all three of you for being applicants. I know two of you,
you ever since you were 13 years old. When you were 15 years old, my mom, my wife and I used to come out and visit your mom and dad. And where did I end up finding you?
Not sure.
Yes, you know.
Oops.
You were on the floor, on your knees, talking to me about being a paramedic.
Correct. Yes, I was.
And every time we went out to visit your mom and dad, first thing is you had a chair waiting for me. You sit on your knees an hour at a time, asking me all kinds of good questions about what it would take to be a paramedic, yet you were only 15 years old. Then when you were 18, you joined the department. You became a very, very fine medic.
Thank you.
I appreciate what you did. Steve, I've only known you for a short time. You seem like a man that is dedicated to the fire service. You have been dedicated all your life. You have a very, very good resume. Joe, first time I ever met you, you were just a young man. I was at the All County Fire Chiefs, or the Firefighters Association meeting at your station. Now, you didn't have a nice station. It was in downtown city of Moorefield. And you were with your dad. I admired your dad because he was a wonderful man, but more than that, he was a wonderful chief. He was admired all over the county by what he did, how he operated, how he treated fellow firefighters. And I would see him at a Clark County Fair whenever New Carlisle would bring their fire engine over there. Sometimes Morford would be leaving, or maybe sometimes he would be coming in. All right, enough of that stuff. What does the word on call mean to all of you?
Always ready.
24/7.
Today's word for... Today's word that we don't use anymore, volunteer.
Always ready.
Yeah. You're right. And always ready means to me, if like the old days when the big siren goes off, if you're home, you're ready. Unless you're incapacitated physically, then of course you're not ready. But if you're ready, you go out that door, whether it's 20 below zero or 95 degrees and 85% humidity. You still go. You sweat or you freeze, but you still go. And that's what the word on call means. If, first of all, New Carlisle Fire Department currently has a long way to go for recovery. I mean a long way to go, as Chief Ritter himself knows. That means we need to bring in new people, whether it be paid on call or whether it be voluntary. You ask her, some people don't think New Carlisle is a volunteer department, but ladies and gentlemen, New Carlisle is a volunteer department, and as long as New Carlisle maintains a city of less than 6,000 people, they will always be a volunteer fire department. That will never change. Syracuse, New York, a city of 250,000 people, is operated by a volunteer fire department. Every one of their stations is filled with volunteer fire department personnel. Now, how do they keep those people there? They keep those people there because they have activities. The main activity is constant training. whether it be with a grass truck or whether it be with a tanker or whether it be with a 105-foot aerial. And that is the only way in a department like New Carlisle or Moorefield is to have training, training, training. Ron, you remember back in the earlier days, we had training the second Thursday of every month. And we always had a good turnout. But we always had an interesting activity, whether it would be putting on a oxygen mask, or whether it was starting up a rescue saw. We always had something that was interesting. We would run charged fire holes throughout the truck or the meeting room and put masks on these firemen with their full turnout gear and make them follow that hose in until they reached the nozzle. What did that teach them? That taught them how to follow the line in and the line out in case they had to get out in a hurry. Al, you were all talking about personnel a while ago and how you talk with personnel. Ron, you remember when you fired me as deputy chief?
Yeah, I did.
And you never, ever invited me to the firehouse to have a talk as to why you were dissatisfied with me.
We can have that conversation.
Huh?
We can have that conversation.
No, I'm going to have it right now.
Okay. I'll answer your question directly. And that question is this. You came to me 20 years ago, and you said, I intend to do this as long as I can. You'd be a good enough friend to me when I reach that point to tell me to step down, and I will do that. All I need you to do is be my friend and tell me to do so. And I did just that.
Ron, you're taking that a little out of context. What I told you was, and you think about this, when I am through, you will be the first to know. And I was still capable, even then, of operating a fire truck. I was capable of operating a ladder truck. But
Mr.
I
Madam,
didn't have the opportunity.
Mr. Madam, it's a five-minute situation.
It's not far from it. It's not far from it. This has to do with dealing with people and listening to people.
Yes, sir, I understand that. But it's a five-minute situation of speaking.
All right.
We appreciate it.
All right. So on call means you will respond when you are available. And if you're in town, unless you're sick, you're available. So let's get this situation in our new recruits that are coming in. If you're home, you're expected to respond, whether it be high, low temperatures, whatever. Now, we have got a contract with Elizabeth Township. The thing that bothers me is if for some reason two people don't show up to remand the squad out there, and let's say a paramedic don't show up, what does New Carlisle have to do? They have to send a paramedic from our station out there to make sure they are manned. And I am totally upset with this. Robbing our station, so Elizabeth Township, who makes 70 runs a year, and we make 1,200 runs a year. Oftentimes we make back-to-back runs, and those people that might be available don't show up. But I am absolutely infuriated that we have to rob our station to send a paramedic from here out there so Elizabeth Township has an on-duty crew of two.
Mr. Madam, this is a question for the candidates. The
It's not, you're making statements now, okay? We appreciate it.
Sometimes you have to get it across in a statement.
You've been over your 5 minutes. We've let you go. Would you please sit
down? All right,
down
my
now?
5 minutes is over then.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Thank you for the comments. Anyone else?
William Lindsay, 314 North Henry Street. My question to you three, whoever is decided, the council decides on hiring for our new fire chief, what would your plan be, or do you have a plan in mind to recruit and bring on volunteers out of this town?
I actually, I'll start that. I've had several conversations with getting in talk with Chief Ritter and Chief Mueller. And I think in part, some of the members that came back are due to their efforts and my efforts too. We're actively recruiting to bring in new talent from outside the area. I would truly like to bridge that gap with the Hispanic community and get them as members of our department. They are members of our community. Let's make them members of our department. And I think we really do need an aggressive program that goes out to the high school and lets these kids know. And it's not just something New Carlisle can do. It's something that we can do with Bethel Township and as a team and try to get them interested. So whether or not they're in Bethel Township, Park Lane or in New Carlisle, we can get them in there because they are our future.
When I started the part-time program in 93, I did a lot of investigation, and at the time I was with the state, I did a lot of traveling. And I had a fire chief down in the south told me, and I'll never forget this, and he pointed his finger at me, don't forget your volunteers. You always will need your volunteers. And be prepared, you're going to lose 10% of your volunteers. I did not. I was very fortunate when we started the program. We had a junior program, and I agree with Ron. You need to get in these high schools and every schools and promote a junior type program. A lot of departments call cadets. And I think by that growing and letting people know, like the gentleman said, maybe a lot of the community that's moved in think it's not a volunteer anymore. I mean, I knew for years it was always a volunteer organization. That maybe a lot of the residents feel that it's just part-time, which we need to volunteer. This is what I would do.
Looking at what we have now, where we stand now, and where we need to be, again, reiterate on both on what Ron and him said as far as getting with the schools and getting with Bethel Park with their cadet program. Those are a lot of areas that we can look at. But also, too, another thing is nowadays, again, being mandated by the state of what a firefighter is required to have to be a firefighter, the schooling and everything. One of the things I would like to research and try to see what we can do as far as getting those classes for those people so they're not having to go out. See what we can do about getting the basic fire school or fire classes brought to us. That way the people that we're bringing in, the volunteers that we're bringing in, they get that training right here. They're not having to go out to get it. And that way, once they are certified, then they can keep going with us by reaching out to the schools, reaching out to the cadet programs, reaching out to the citizens. And I feel also, too, that's part of the fire chief's job is not only being in the firehouse and not being taking care of that business, but also is being out in the public with the other community efforts that are going on, the other clubs, the other projects that are going on in the community. I feel the fire chief needs to make his presence known there. A lot of times that's where you may pick up some volunteers, or that's where you may pick up some type of help. I know how we can get to that class for your department. I know how we can get this for the department. Making those connections. It's not just in the firehouse. It's in the entire city.
One thing, if I could add, I forgot. I reached out to our new superintendent to see about the possibilities of actually having an elective at Tecumseh High School that would allow the students to become an EMT while still in high school. He's open to discussing it. Obviously needs lots more information, but the door is cracked open for that. And that might build some possibilities for both the township and for our community.
Okay. One more question. If you have a firefighter EMT has a problem with a lieutenant and or a captain, and they come to you, would you have an open door policy, or would you tell them to go back to the lieutenant or captain?
That's a difficult question. According, I mean, if it's a sexual harassment issue, I don't know that we send them right back go see your lieutenant. So I think it would have to be dealt case by case. But I would be interested in what the details are, and then I'd make a recommendation as to what I'd like to see them.
Okay.
I'd probably ask basically the same thing. Have you gone through the lieutenant or captain yet? Yes, depends on the situation.
Okay.
Same thing, also depending on the situation, but also to their, in our department is paramilitary organization. There is a chain of command, there's a reason for it. Mm-hmm. If the firefighter has a problem with that lieutenant or with his captain, then I would approach both of them and sit down with both of them and can say, okay, find out what the situation is. Again, according to what the severity of the situation or the problem may be.
Okay, good answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. I have a question for you, if you would, please. There's two of you that's currently on the department. How is the department running at this particular time?
I think it's a work in progress. You had to go through the period of, before this department could really start rebuilding. A lot of the folks are on the edge. It's almost like having a United States without a president. They've got to have that leadership and that permanent leadership. Rick's doing a fine job as an interim chief, but the fact of the matter is Rick don't want to be in that position any longer than he absolutely has to be. And the people are being tolerant, but they want that leadership back in here.
You need strong leadership.
Steve?
I think the department itself as a whole is doing the same job it always does, protect the city, protect the citizens. Chief Ritter, I've known Rick for a real long time, from base and everything else. Again, Rick stepping in like he's done, especially with the condition, what he's already went through, has done a fantastic job of getting the department, keeping the department going. As Ron said, yeah, there is probably sure some people that are sitting there on the fence of, well, I'll wait to see what they do, who they hire, who they don't hire, who's going to be the chief, how's he going to run the department, and go from there. But you have that in any fire department. I don't care if it's a volunteer, part-time paid, full-time paid. You have that anywhere. Right now, I think the department's running well. I think the morale is definitely on an upswing in a lot of the areas from what it was. I feel there's a lot more relaxation in the department coming in the door. It's not walking in the door, what's the drama today? And I think that's due to a lot of the I try to be politically correct. Sometimes a dumb marine comes out of me. It's time to let the past be the past. It's time to put this department forward and continue moving forward. You can't change the past. It's time to quit chewing on it.
Do other firefighters and EMTs in the back of the room there, anybody have a comment on that as far as how you think the department's running now? You do feel that it's coming together? The battery is back? Go ahead, please. Be with it.
My name's Larry Trusty, firefighter EMT, New Carlisle Fire Division. Fire Division as a whole, like the other members have said, it's going forward. The morale is getting better. People are a lot happier at work. People are getting out there, picking up open shifts, wanting to be there, wanting to put the extra time and forth in. I think everything's going great. I think the morale is on an upswing, and it's only getting better as the days go on. And I think we're becoming more redirected on what we need to be doing as firefighters, EMTs, paramedics, and officers for our community and for our citizens. So as far as I'm concerned, the department's doing great.
Good to hear. Thank you. Anyone else like to comment? We have you on the back there, please, for everyone with the department. Okay, but you all would agree things are getting better. Morale's up. Things are looking better. I see heads shaking.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Joe, how would you respond now to the same question? Morale is evidently coming up and so forth. If you were to get the job and take over, coming in from the outside, how would you look at it this way?
Well, I would probably obviously take a few days to look at it myself to see, you know, what I feel it is, and then pull the department probably individually and ask them what the concerns are, what they like to see, what they like to see differently, and get their feel, get their input. Obviously, from the outside, I definitely do that.
Thank you. Anyone else? Any other questions with anybody?
I just have one quick question.
Please go ahead.
This, I'm Kathy Boyko. I talked to the two of you. When I interviewed the former chief, the most recent former chief, he noted that he wanted to move to just paramedics and firefighters. He was not interested in EMTs. How do you feel your department, what would be the makeup of your department? Would you agree with that philosophy?
Not at all. I got to tell you, I purposely, a lot of my career ran with an EMT as a partner. A good, strong EMT is as valuable as a paramedic. And quite frankly, sometimes as a paramedic, I kind of like to do my own thing. And I don't, I mean, you get knee deep in alligators, doesn't mean you don't welcome help. But a lot of times paramedics pick up their own style in doing their job. They like their own needles. They like to do their own intubations. And having an EMT, a good EMT with you, game on.
The same as Ron was saying, basic EMT is invaluable. I've been one since, like I said, for 34 years, worked with a lot of different departments, worked with a lot of different paramedics. And any good EMT that works with a good paramedic, that paramedic's gonna start the line, that paramedic's gonna push the drug, but that EMT better know where the drug is, which one that paramedic wants, how to get it ready. He better know how to, or she better know how to spike a bag. They better know what needle, what size that paramedic will use for what type of call it is. That way, that paramedic is concentrating on that patient. That basic EMT takes a lot of load off of that paramedic. And do our department, do we need to go to full time? Yeah, it would be fantastic if we could say, yeah, we got full paramedics. That's all we got. That would be fantastic, but that's not going to happen.
In the EMT, I was the EMT when the paramedic program first started in Clark County. I have to say, the EMT stopped, he was out the door, and we wasn't. We were right there. I still remember the first code working with the paramedic. I was right there working with them side by side. So you need your EMTs, you need your basic. I know some people think, well, if you're part-time, we need to provide the highest level, which would be the paramedic, but that's just not feasible all the time. You need your EMTs.
Thank you. You're welcome. I saw somebody in the back wanted to speak. Go ahead, please.
Yeah.
We're going to wind it down here pretty soon. It's a little after 9 already, so if you want to speak, let's...
Sorry, modern technology. I didn't have a pen, so I used my phone.
Did you let us have your name?
I'm sorry. Steve Schaefer, firefighter paramedic for the city. A handy coined phrase, paramedics save patients, EMTs save paramedics. So, my question to the three of you, sirs, is... the gentleman up here hit on it, but I would like to know, what are your specific 30-day and 90-day goals for this division?
Initially, I want to take a look at a hard look at the budget, see where we're at. Fiscally, I mean, are we in trouble? Or are we not in trouble? We're at the end of the year, so we may have to be doing some kind of moving of funds to make sure that we stay out of the red. 90-day goals, we can get that second medic out, and that we continue increasing that membership. Take a hard look at what we need to get. I believe that there's some capital equipment that we're gonna make our minds up pretty quick as what we're gonna do, and what the immediate needs are with regards to safety equipment. 30-90 is where I'm at.
30 days looking at, again, as Ron said, the budget's got to be your main focus at first. Any new fire chief coming in the door, whether you've been in that fire department for 5 minutes or 50 years, you better look at the budget first, because you can't spend money you don't have. And looking at where the money needs to go, where we need to look at. 90-day, I think we need to look at our officer ranks right now, because we are in a little bit of a transition there also. I think that needs to be looked at and to see where we need to go from that, what we really need versus what we have had, and go from there. And then also, as Ron said, capital improvements. One of the biggest things Chief Ritter has already spearheaded and took care of for us is getting a compressor and cascade system, which takes one really big, huge load off the department, big asset. And I think one of the next things that we need to look at before we're mandated to do it is putting every one of our firefighters in their own mask and possibly own mask and regulator. Because I feel that is going to come down as an OSHA and NFPA regulation very soon. And I think we need to be ahead of the curve. And for first off, it's a safety factor for that firefighter.
30 days, obviously, is the budget also for me. And also, I want to make sure that all the equipment is up to speed. Have we had our hose test for the year? Have we had our pump test? Have we had our ladders test? Again, that goes back to safety for the firefighters. Then I would look at the manpower, and obviously, not knowing your officer structure, I would get into officer structure and see if we need to change that. And I look at that, obviously, but that's down the road. That'd be 90 days plus. I'm not going to do that overnight. I would look at that a little bit on that.
Great, great answers. And most of tonight's been kind of bragging, I would say, about each one of you. I would like to know, what is your greatest weakness that you would say that you have?
I still don't like seeing loss of life. I really don't. And as hard as you try, as many years as you go on, still, they say you get over it, but when you see a young one die, you remember that the rest of your life. And while you try your greatest, and sometimes you succeed, there's far too many other tragedies that occur, even if they're once every 3 years. It's pretty tough to deal with.
I think all three of us could probably sit here and talk about incidents we've had. I had five teenagers get killed in the auto accident from suicide. It's just devastating. You never get over that, and you worry about your firefighters. You have to, take care of them, get some help for them, and counseling, whatever.
True, the weaknesses can be that. I mean, as far as, like you said, I've had two babies die in my arms, but those weaknesses there, I think the fire service has taken along a large leap as far as CISM teams and that type of thing, which I'm also part of the county CISM team, critical stress debriefing teams. As far as personally, I think my weakest point sometimes is the fact that I try really hard. I want to get something done, and accepting the fact, it's not going to happen this time, but never giving up.
If I can add, one of my other weaknesses too is, because I've been around too much, I really try to avoid this, and I really work hard at it, and it's micromanaging. You just can't micromanage, and that's probably one of the worst things I have to just pass it on, make sure they do it.
Okay, thank you. Could we have one more person? We'll call it a night here. Who else would like to speak?
I'd also like to thank all three of these fine gentlemen for applying for our city and showing such great interest in coming and being our leader.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Lowry has a question.
Thank you. My question is for the people sitting in the back, and this is going to be a tough question, and nobody may want to stand up and answer it. I don't know, but I'm going to ask the question. Our fire department in New Carlisle went through some pretty bad turmoil. My question to you is, does anyone think, or just give me an opinion, if any one of these gentlemen sitting back there are appointed fire chief? I've heard everybody sit back there and say everything's on the upswing, morale's on the upswing, everything's on the upswing. But that trend would be reversed. If you don't answer, I completely understand. You don't have to.
Got the city manager.
Can you email me that response, please?
And You can call me from a friend's phone.
Email the response.
If you don't want to answer that. And I understand the one more. But that is very important question. And when you're deciding who to call me,
let's have one more, if you will.
Do you want to answer this question again?
Yeah, you can answer the question.
Okay. Bill Baker, up the Members Fire Division. And your question, repeat your question one more time so I get it right.
What I want to know is if anybody thinks that one of these gentlemen is appointed fire chief, we may start losing that upswing, and we may become starting to lose the body again. I don't know how the fire department thinks.
Under Chief Ritter's direction, we have greatly improved, and I mean big time, not just a little. We have done great. I know two of the candidates very well. Both of them would do an excellent job. Mr. Stalder, I've been out of town. I just come back and read your short resume and heard you tonight. I'm guessing that you would be in that same category. I mean, I don't want to deny you. Well, I'm not sure how to say that, but not putting you down. I just don't know other than what I've read. And I'm sure you would do fine. Is that adequate?
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Phil.
Can I add something to that?
Absolutely. And I think you know what I'm looking for. I'm not trying to put you or anybody else on the spot.
I think with what the department has been through, I don't think that the members of the department are going to allow that to happen again. It might have gotten rolling downhill without anybody realizing it. That will never happen again. That I can assure you. Everybody's going to be watching, listening, and now knows what the consequences are of letting that go that way. So I don't think the department would allow it.
I will take your word anytime. I'll be completely honest with you. I was hoping that someone would stand up and say, I don't know what terminology do I want to use. That element is gone. It's still gone.
No, it's gone.
And that doesn't exist anymore.
No.
And that's what I was trying to ask for. But I wasn't really pursuing
it. We have the potential to be any department we want to be. We have the potential financially, maybe not now, but the drive is there, potential is there.
That's great.
To have what we want. And as a firefighter, all these firefighters, they will support any chief that gives them a chance to do what they want.
If you say it, I'll thank you.
It's fact.
Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it.
Mr. Mayor, I got a quick question for Chief Ritter, if I can. It's a yes or no question.
Go ahead, please.
No.
Are you going to stay on as assistant chief when the new chief is appointed, or are you retiring?
No, I'm planning on staying.
Yes, he's staying.
That's all I want to know, sir. Thank you.
Okay. All right, sir, everyone, it's now 9:15 at night. We have one more comment.
All right, first of all, thank you three for coming. I appreciate you taking time out of your busy scope to come. Mr. Lowey, that was a fantastic question. I didn't want a particular name to be drawn, but I understand why you asked that. But to piggyback on my email request, every one of these council members, if you see their first name, if you want to email them, it is their first initial, last name, @newcarlisle.net. So if you have any information that you want to share with them, my email address is rbridge@newcarlisle.net. One thing I will ask all current fire personnel when I was here, shoot me an email and let me know how you think tonight. And you don't have to give me your preference. I will be able to follow up on what you say in the email. But you are your opinion is highly valued in my eyes. You are the one who has to report directly to me to whatever gentleman we decide on. That person will report directly to me. So you're the one who has to work for that person. So anything you can give me, it would be greatly appreciated.
What time frame are you now looking at to?
What are you wanting to appoint next?
What age is that?
Next year, next July.
Next July.
New fire chief.
Appointment of the new fire chief. Would that be at the next council meeting?
It depends on how the interview goes.
I didn't know if you had to make a decision at the council meeting, like under.
Yeah, so it's only fine.
Okay.
I'm city manager of my decision.
Oh, okay.
I do not have to put it into council. It's not a city administration position, so it will be my decision.
want to clarify something. You had mentioned the websites, the email for all the council members. Just to clarify for the audience, if you go to the city webpage and you click on council, you'll see the list of all the council members, and all you need to do is click on their name, and immediately kicks them into their email account. So it's that easy to send them a note. It means that you guys have to check that all the time just to make sure people can read
and forward me their email. Again, my email address is rbridge, not put an S in my last name. Why do you do it? Bridge, not bridges. Because you do it with an S, you never have so that's all I have. So, council.
Hey, I want to thank the candidates for being here. Thank you for sitting through with everyone. Thank everybody else for being here tonight. This has been an open forum. It's a good thing for the city. Whomever city manager chooses, we hope you go forward, continue to do what's being happened now. So thank you all for being here tonight. Council, thank you all for being here.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I move we adjourn.
We are.